Hello. In the last lectures, we have already seen a number of limit theorems in probability. We have seen the most important one, or the most simple one, maybe the law of large numbers, that says that if we take the average over IID random variables, this empirical average is going to converge to the true expected value of the underlying distribution. And we've also seen the central limit theorem that says if we look again at a sum of independent random variables, and if we normalize that sum appropriately, then the expression is going to converge in distribution to a standard normal distribution. Now, the Glivenko-Kantelli theorem is yet another limit theorem. The Glivenko-Kantelli theorem, in a nutshell, it looks at the cumulative distribution function. And now assume we have the true underlying cumulative distribution function, and now we observe many random variables, x1 to xn, from this underlying distribution. Based on these observations, we can now construct an empirical cumulative distribution function. And the theorem now states that this empirical CDF is going to converge to the true underlying CDF, even uniformly. Now, the statement has a couple of applications. So, for example, in statistics, later on we are going to see that one can base the Kolmogorov-Smirnov to sample test based on the statistics. But to be honest, it is not so extremely important and interesting. So why are we talking about the theorem right now? The reason is the proof. So the proof I want to show you for that theorem is a very typical proof, as it always occurs in statistical learning theory. So in statistical learning theory, you will very often see the situation that you need to prove that the supremum over a family of random variables converges to something, or to zero typically. And this is exactly what we're now going to look at for the Glivenko-Kantelli theorem. Now, maybe you might want to note that there is, if you're just interested in the statement of the theorem and not in statistical learning theory, there is a simpler proof for that theorem, a much simpler proof, but it's even a bit boring. So what I want to look at now is, I want to give you the more complicated proof, the one that has the gist as it's always used in learning theory. And I think it is really important, at least if you want to understand learning theory later on, this is a first example for this proof technique, and you're going to see many more of these proof techniques, but here we can practice it for the first time, and this is why I want to show you the theorem. So let us get started. So assume we have F is a CDF, a cumulative distribution function. So we're looking at random variables on R, F is the CDF. So this means that F of A is the probability that this random variable X that we're currently looking at is smaller or equal to A. So this is the underlying distribution. Now assume that we sample points, sample random variables from this distribution. So let X1 to Xn be sampled according to F IID. Okay, we independently draw n random variables according to this cumulative distribution function. Okay, and maybe I might even want to make a picture at the side. So maybe our cumulative, that's maybe too large, sorry. Maybe the cumulative distribution function looks like this. If you remember, a cumulative distribution function approaches zero at one end, it approaches one at the other end, it's monotonously in between. It might be discontinuous, at least in one direction, but let's just look at this simple case here. So this is the cumulative distribution function f. Now we have seen these n sample points, and now we can construct the empirical cumulative distribution function, namely the cumulative distribution that corresponds to the empirical measure induced by the sample. So let me write this down. So now we define fn of a. So maybe fn, maybe just to make it a bit more precise, fn is a function that goes from r to 0, 1. F as well is a function that goes from r to 0, 1. So fn of a is now defined as 1 over n sum over I from 1 to n, the characteristic function that the random variable xi is smaller or equal to a. Okay, so let's look at this. So we sum here the characteristic functions that the random variables are smaller or equal to A, which essentially tells us what, according to this empirical distribution of the axis, is the likelihood that we end up with something smaller than A. Now, if n is what we call the empirical distribution function, and it is of course a step function, because like it, we have discrete random variables, so they increase by certain steps. So always in discrete levels, they decrease by 1 over n. So this empirical distribution function might look like this. Oh, sorry, I mean, of course, it should cover the whole space somehow. This is not drawn very accurately. Okay. So the empirical distribution function, so this is fn, the blue curve in this plot. The empirical distribution function, hopefully, or this is what you would hope, is close to the true red distribution function. And this is now what the Glivenko-Cantelli theorem is going to say. Maybe before we dive into that theorem, let's look at one particular thing. Let us maybe look at what happens if we fix one particular A. Now fix one particular, say, A0 in R. And now we want to consider what happens to Fn of A0. So this means we are now at one particular value A0, and we want to know how far is the blue curve from the red curve. And now the trick is, if we now look at Fn of A0, this converges to f of A0 by the law of large numbers. By the law of large numbers. And why is this the case? Because, I mean, just look at this expression here. We have here a family of random variables. These random variables are either 0 or 1. And they are 0 with a certain probability and 1 with a different probability. And that holds for all the i's. They all have the same distribution because the xi's are being sampled from the same underlying distribution. So we can say that, maybe I write in because the random variable 1, xi smaller than a, is a binomial random variable with, like, binomial random variables, if you remember, it's a coin, head, tail, 0, 1, with probability p, and the parameter p is now the probability that xi is smaller than a, okay? And so if a is fixed, a0, I need to write here. So if a0 is fixed, then this p, if you want, p0 is also fixed. So we always have the same random variable, we repeat it, we take the average, and this, of course, by the law of large numbers, converges to the underlying correct value, the f of a0. So this is clear. So it is clear that fn to f pointwise. So for each point, I mean, and this holds almost truly, pointwise, by pointwise I mean for all a0. So this is obvious, but now we want to look at the uniform conversions. And this is what the Glivenko-Cantelli theorem says. Now let's look at uniform convergence. And recall, what is uniform convergence? In uniform convergence, we need to go along the whole space and see what is the maximal distance between these two curves, between the blue and the red one, and to the two functions converge uniformly if the distance over the whole space uniformly gets smaller. So the maximum or supremum distance between these, the red and the blue curve, gets close to zero. And this is now what I want to write down, theorem. So this is the Glivenko-Cantelli theorem. So let x1 to xn be random variables, iid random variables with CDF f. let Fn be the empirical CDF induced by the sample. As I've just defined it before. Then what do we have? And now the statement comes even with deviation guarantee, so the probability, and I first write it down, that the supremum over A and R of the quantity Fn of A minus F of A, that the probability that this guy is larger than epsilon is smaller than 8 times n plus 1 times e to the minus n epsilon square over 32. Okay, so in particular, I'll decrypt it in a minute, so just let me finish writing. In particular, the supremum of Fn minus F converges to zero almost surely, and if you want to say that is Fn to F uniformly almost surely. Okay, now that's a complicated theorem, let's look at it. So we want to know that we look at the distance between Fn and F. This is the quantity we're interested in. And we look at the supremum over all of A. So previously we have just looked at one A0, now we look at the supremum over all A, and we want to know what is the probability that this supremum is larger than epsilon. So if I'm supposed to draw a figure here, so this is the true distribution function. This is the empirical one, maybe. Oh no, it can't decrease. That was bad, let me try. Something like that. And now we want to know whether, so essentially we take a band of width epsilon, so if this is supposed to be epsilon, the green band, then we want to know how likely is it that the supremum is large, is outside of this green guy. And the answer that is given by the theorem is, this probability is given by this expression here, so this and this should also already ring a bell. These kind of expressions, they look like Hoeffding's inequality. I mean, maybe different constants and so on. But whenever you see in learning theory or in probability theory, you see e to the minus n epsilon square, you immediately need to think, I mean, either Hoeffding or concentration inequality. So this is what we have here. And now observe, we have n times this e to the minus n epsilon square. So for each fixed epsilon, this expression is definitely going to go to zero, because we have e to the minus n that goes to zero very fast. We have this factor n, but this is dominated by this term going to zero very fast, so this whole product is going to go to zero reasonably fast. And by itself, now this is first of all a statement for convergence in probability. And then the typical thing, we've already seen that argument, once we have such an concentration inequality that gives us convergence in probability, we use the Borel-Cantelli lemma to get the uniform convergence. Okay, so this is the Glienko-Cantelli theorem. And now we want to prove that. Let's look at the proof. Maybe I want to give you a couple of remarks first. So observe that by the law of large numbers, we have already seen that we have that the probability that Fn of A0 minus F of A0 larger than epsilon goes to zero. So this is the statement I made in the beginning when I said if we fix some value A0, then by the law of large numbers, the distribution function, the empirical distribution function, is going to converge to the true one, so definitely this absolute value, the probability that this is larger than epsilon goes to zero, because this is convergence in probability. Now for any fixed A0. So this is simple. But what we have to look at is now the expression where we don't have just Fn of A minus F of A for one particular value of A, but we have the supremum inside here. And this is what really makes it difficult. Our problem, if you want, is now we need to look at the expression P supremum A and R, and then Fn of A minus F of A larger than epsilon. And the supremum, this is difficult. Because in particular, I mean, R is an uncountable set. So if this would be a finite thing, if we would, maybe I write first difficult because R is uncountable. And now maybe it's not obvious what countability has to do with the fact that that's difficult, but I want to give you the intuition. If we take a supremum over a finite set, we take a finite supremum, a supremum over a finite set, it is easier. Because then what we can do is, if we have, for example, the probability, so the supremum over a finite set is in fact a maximum, that the maximum over I equals 1 to n, from 1 to n, for example, some expression ui, I don't know, is larger than epsilon, if this is what I want to prove, then what would we do? I mean, this means the maximum being larger than epsilon means there needs to be at least one guy of these uis that is larger than epsilon. So this would be either u1 is larger than epsilon, or u2 is larger than epsilon, or and so on, until we are or un is larger than epsilon. So we have an or conjunction between all these events, and now we know that this can be always bounded by the sum I equals 1 to n of the probability that ui is larger than epsilon. Okay, so in this case, if you have a finite, if we have finitely many elements in our supremum or the maximum, then we can always use this union bound argument here, take it out by a sum, so then we get rid of the maximum or the supremum, and now this term that we are left with, like the one here at the end, this is now something we might be able to bound, like in the law of large numbers, because now we have it for a fixed, not for, as a supremum, but just for one fixed element here. And now the trick of the proof of the Glivenko-Cantelli theorem, as I want to show it here, is to convert the statement in such a way that we have something finite here in the soup. So the trick of the proof convert soup A in R to something finite. Whatever that means for now. But this is maybe something you might want to keep in mind. I'm trying to refer to it over and over again. But this is what we need to achieve. Okay. And now that was, in German we would say das Vorgeplänkel. I don't know how you would express that in English. This was the remarks I wanted to know before we get started. Now let's get started with the proof. So we make step one. And now the step has a funny, we are not yet ready. I want to explain to you in a minute why this trick is going to work. So how could we achieve that? Achieve this. Now I draw again a plot. So here we have a cumulative distribution function f, and now we have, maybe that's the empirical distribution function fn. Now observe this empirical distribution function, again I didn't really plot it very well. This empirical distribution function only takes finitely many values, okay, the blue one. Now, f is the problem. If you want to take the supremum over the difference between the blue and the red guy, f takes infinitely many values, continuously many, so this is nothing finite. But now what would happen if instead of the blue function, we would have this green function here. This is also an empirical distribution function, maybe, of yet another sample. And this is, and I'm going to go to tell you in a minute, this is going to be Fn prime induced by what we call ghost sample. I'm going to explain it in a minute. But so assume, so the blue function is induced by the true sample. Maybe I've read this. Induced by given sample. And the red guy, maybe just to complete the figure, is the true underlying function. True function. Okay, and now we're interested in the difference between the blue and the red one. Now assume we had a second sample, x1 prime to xn prime. It has the same number of sample points, it's completely independent of the first sample, it's been generated by the same underlying mechanism. So the second sample, what is going to be called the ghost sample, because this is something we have in our mind, in our head, but it doesn't really exist. This ghost sample would also produce an empirical distribution function, the green one. And now if you look at the green and the you know that the blue you want to prove that the blue function is going to converge to the red function. If this holds for the blue function, it is also going to hold for the green function, because it's a function generated by the same mechanism. So probably it would be enough to prove that if you have two independent samples, the blue one and the green one, then the distance between the blue and the green function is going to be small. Okay, now the intuition is going to be, if the blue guy and the red guy are close, then the green guy and the red guy are also going to be close. And then I can bound this somehow by twice the distance between the green and the blue one. So somehow what I want to say is something like, I'm interested in red minus blue. And this is somehow the same as at least in distribution as red minus green. And this is going to be smaller than 2 times the distance between green minus blue. Because I can go from the blue to the red and then from the red to the blue. This is the intuition that I want to show. I'm not sure whether this is going to help you in understanding it. Let me try to explain it once more. I want to show that the red and the blue guy are close, and similarly the green and the red guy are close, because green and blue are generated by the same mechanism. And the idea is I can bound the red minus blue distance by twice the green minus blue, essentially by saying, well, I go from green to red and then from red to blue. And now the idea is these green and these blue curves, they have finitely many steps. So if I want to look at the distance between green and blue, there are only finitely many distances between these green and blue curves. Because, let me just point it out, so here the distance is constant, like this is just one value. Now here it changes because the green curve makes a step, and then it changes here because now the blue curve makes a step. So the steps do not necessarily happen at the same time. So here's yet another example. Here we have a certain constant phase where the distance is constant, and then the blue curve changes, the distance is constant here, and so on. So, but there are only finitely many different distances that we need to look at. And this is what we want to achieve by introducing what is called a ghost sample. And now we're trying to do that. We leave the intuition and now we do the proof. Step one of the proof. This step is called symmetrization by a ghost sample. Now the idea is, so assume that x1 prime to xn prime has also been generated according to F, independently. So all these points are RID between themselves and also independent from the first sample. And this is what we call our ghost sample. So we don't have that, but we just assume we had it. And we denote by Fn prime the empirical CDF induced by this ghost sample. So in the plot above, that's the green curve. And now one can prove a very simple, straightforward statement. Now it is easy to prove. And I'm going to write this down now first, and then I'm going to explain it. The probability, so we look at the supremum over A. A is always in the real numbers. I'm not going to repeat this in every line. Supremum over A, Fna minus F of A. The probability that this guy is larger than epsilon can now be bounded by twice the probability. So we still have the supremum over A, but now Fn of A minus Fn prime of A is larger than, and now we have epsilon over 2. So what has changed here? So here we look at, this is the blue curve minus the red curve. Maybe I just underline it. So this is blue. Here is it's also blue. This is red. And now this other term here is the green one. That is the green one in our plot. Okay, so what we now look at is the supremum over the empirical CDF minus the true one. And essentially it is some kind of triangle inequality argument that says this can be at most can be bounded by twice the distance between Fn, like the empirical one according to the true sample, and the empirical sample. And so we get this factor 2 here, and if you do the argument correctly, you also get a larger than epsilon over 2. So do you get this 2 here, this 1/2, as an additional factor. Okay, and I don't want to go into how this is being proved. It's not difficult, but I simply want to save a bit of time here. And this step is called symmetrization by a ghost sample, because what we have now is we have a term that does not, it does not depend on the true underlying CDF. It now depends just on two empirical CDFs. And the whole point of this argument is that these are now functions with finitely many steps. And so in the end, it's going to help us to get the supremum out of this probability. Okay. Now the second step in the proof is going to be, we now want to split this into two terms that are like one term that corresponds to Fn and another term that corresponds to Fn prime. Because this is going to make our life easier. Now want to split this in two terms. And now what we're going to do to this end is we're going to exploit the symmetry here, because these two terms are sort of symmetric, so they're Fn and Fn prime have the same distribution. So I could exchange Fn and Fn prime here and nothing would change in this probability. And to this end, we do the following. So we first of all observe if we have Fn of A minus Fn prime of A. This is just by definition 1 over sum I equals 1 to n. The characteristic function that xi is smaller than A minus the characteristic function that xi prime is smaller than A. Okay, so this term corresponds to the true empirical, like to the blue empirical distribution function, and this one to the ghost sample, to the green one. Oh, and there's an absolute value missing here. Okay. And now, as I said, the roles of xi and xi prime are symmetric, and we now bring this out in terms of a random variable. So now what we do is we introduce what is called Rademacher random variables. Sigma 1 to sigma n. So I don't know, in fact, why they are called like this literature always calls them Rademacher random variables. That's why I also call them this way. But essentially, it's just a binary random variable that takes values 0 and 1 with probability 1/2. So sigma I of 0 is the same as sigma I of 1, which is 1/2. Sorry, it's not 0, it's minus 1 and 1. Sorry, essentially these are random signs, minus 1 and 1. And then the probability is of course not 1 but 1 half. So we throw a coin and either the sign is minus 1 or it's plus 1. And with this, now what we can say is that the distribution, and now maybe call this quantity here, this guy we call star. And now the distribution of this red star is the same as the distribution of the following term, and now I write it down. So it is 1 over n sum I equals 1 to n. Now comes this random sign sigma I, 1 over xi smaller than a minus 1 xi prime smaller or equal to a. And now the absolute value is missing here. Maybe let's call it 2 star. And now let's try to see why this is true. So here, I mean, if you compare this term here, the 2 star term, with the 1 star term, it's exactly identical except that we have this random sign here. Now the point is the probability whether this term, the difference between these two random variables, is positive or negative, it has probability 1 half to be minus 1 or plus 1. So because they have the same distribution and with the same, the probability that one is larger than the other is the same as the other way around. So this is symmetric in this sense. And this random variable just expresses the symmetry in a better way. And this helps us now then to split these two random variables. And now we can compute. Now we have. Let's start on the next page. So we have twice the two probabilities, that's what, where we come out from the symmetrization lemma, supremum over A, Fn of A minus Fn prime of A. The probability that this is larger than epsilon 2. This is what comes from the symmetrization lemma, right? This is what we get. And now we want to bound it. So this is now the same as the probability sub A, oh, and there is this, oh no, I have Fn, okay. And now 1 over n, sum sigma I, characteristic function that xi is smaller than a, minus characteristic function that xi prime is smaller than a, and the probability that this guy is larger than epsilon over 2. Okay? So now we have a supremum here over this term, over this sum here, and we want to look at when is this sum larger or small, or when is it larger than epsilon over 2. And now what we can do is a bit of a, we do a trick, and I first write it down and then I explain why this is true. So I want to, I first write down what I want to achieve. Namely, now I want to split it into the two terms. So this is a supremum over A, 1 over n sum over sigma I characteristic function xi is smaller than a, that this guy is larger than, now we have epsilon over 4, plus twice the probability, same expression, just with x prime, sup, 1 over n sum sigma I characteristic function that xi prime is smaller or equal to a, larger than epsilon over 4. Now let's look at this. So now I have, essentially what I did is I have this term with these xi's, and I have the same term with the xi primes. And now the xi primes end up here, and the xi's end up here. And essentially I split this probability now, but just instead of epsilon over 2, I now have epsilon over 4. And this looks, first of all, a bit of a miracle. Why can we split that? Because here we have this absolute value around these guys, and that sounds a bit strange. But the reason is as follows. So why does this work? Here's the explanation. Observe. If you have something like, you look at the probability that u minus v is larger than epsilon over 2. So u is essentially, so this is essentially what I call u here. Well, yes. And this is what I call V. Okay? And in the first expression, the line above, we have them in the same absolute value. And now I want to say this is smaller or equal than the probability that U is larger than epsilon over 4 plus the probability, I'm still inside the probability at this point, or V is larger than epsilon over 4. And now, how does this come? So essentially what we have here is the right side is necessary for the left side. So you have now on the right side, you have, assume the right side is not, so the event in the inside the probability of course is not true. So then U is smaller than epsilon over 4 and V is smaller than epsilon over 4. So then the sum, no matter what the science is, can never be something that is larger than epsilon over 2. So if you want that this absolute value is larger than epsilon over 2, at least either U or V needs to be at least over epsilon over 4. And if you have such a necessary thing, this means essentially the right side implies, the right side is necessary, but maybe not sufficient. So there might be more things on the right side than on the left side. So this is why the probability has the smaller or equal sign. And this is now, end of the long story, why this inequality sign here holds. Okay. Now what we have achieved is that we have now split this complicated probability, which involves sample and ghost sample, into two probabilities. And these terms are exactly the same, except that here we have xi and here we have xi prime. Now xi and xi prime come from the same underlying distribution, they're independent, so instead of having these two terms, I can also write this is the same as 4 times the first probability, right? So this is, let me write it down, 4 times the probability, and now I write it again, sub of a, 1 over n, sum sigma I, 1 over xi minus a is smaller than a, and this whole guy needs to be larger than epsilon over 4. Okay? So this last step was easy. And now comes this finite, now we have an expression here that contains this empirical distribution function and nothing else. So this is now a step function with finitely many steps. And I'm always going to ask is essentially this, so I now introduced random signs, and when is this sum, this whole sum, larger or smaller than epsilon over 4? And now we exploit, now comes step 3. Exploit finite structure. So I want to say, okay, and now the trick is, I want to say that independently of what these exact realization of the random variables xi are, I have this finite structure. So what we're now going to do is we fix the xi's, x1 to xn. And fixing means is going to be we condition on x1 to xn. So conditioning intuitively means we fix them to a particular value. So we want to look at the probability that something happens conditioned on the fact that these x's take certain values. And now what we do is we look at the characteristic function that xi is smaller or equal to a. And now look at what happens here. So we have now we have all the x's. And now the question is always, is the first x, so the question is, if we look over all the x's, so x1 to xn, how many different realizations can these random variables have? And they can only have n plus 1 realizations. So maybe I write this differently. The random variables, x1 smaller than a, 1 to xn smaller than a, for fixed for fixed A can only have n plus 1 realizations. So if I assume the random variables are sorted for now, then the A could either be somewhere in this interval, or it could be somewhere in this, or somewhere in this. So I have these n plus 1 different places where this A could be. And depending on in which of these intervals it ends, so these other random variables xi are either smaller or larger. And there are only n plus 1 cases where this A can end up. And now maybe let's try to do this argument formally. Now what we want to do is we want to compute the probability that there's a premium of A, 1 over n, sum sigma I, characteristic function xi smaller than A, is larger than epsilon over 4. And now we condition this on x1 to xn. And now this is, by the argument we've just made, we have only finitely, namely n plus 1 many cases, what can happen here. And then we use the union bound. So now we do what we had in the very beginning when we said we now have, a bit slower. So this supremum over A, while it here goes still over uncountably many things, we just have seen that in fact this supremum only goes over these n plus 1 different cases. So this is a supremum over n plus 1 different cases, so I in fact can take it out. And so then what is going to happen is this is smaller than the supremum epsilon A P 1 over n sum sigma I characteristic function x I smaller than A larger than epsilon over 4 conditioned on x1 to xn. Okay, and now observe, because we condition now here on these random variables, the xn's are sort of fixed in this statement. This is also what goes on here. So so here the A is fixed, the xi is fixed, so that's why I can sort of get it out. And then the only random variables we now have left are the sigma i's. So this probability here in fact only runs over the sigma i's because the x's are fixed. And now the trick is going to be, this is going to be bounded by Hüsch-Höfting. So this is going to be the last step. Step four, I guess. It says step five here. Step three, I don't have a step four. So step four, Höfting. Now we can apply Höfting to this expression. Maybe let's call it hash. Now I didn't really specify Höfting inequality for conditional random variables, and I don't want to go into it, but in principle you can do that because now you fix these random variables and all you're interested in is the random variable sigma I here. And so what we get is for all A, and this statement is now independent of A, we have that the probability that 1 over n sum sigma I characteristic function xi smaller than A larger than epsilon over 4, the absolute value is missing, and now conditioned on x1 to xn, and this can now, we can exploit Höfting, 2 e to the minus, maybe I write it down first, n epsilon square over 32. And where does the 32, in Höfting typically we don't have a 32 at the bottom, but we get this because we have epsilon square, and the epsilon square is the 16, like if we square this 4 we get 16, so we typically have 2 here in the bottom, so this is 2 times 16. Okay. Okay, so we get a factor of 2 here, and now we plug everything together. If you look back at the statement of the theorem, that's not very far away. So the statement says here, 8 n plus 1 e to the minus n epsilon square over 32. Now let's see here. So here we have this e to the minus n epsilon square over, oh no, over 2. The blind is going to raise, but I'm finished in a moment. Here we have a factor of 2. And but we had previously here we have this factor n minus n plus 1, and we also had the factor 4 here, so 4 times 2 is 8. So this is why in the end we obtain the theorem of Klevenko-Cantelli. So I just write, combining everything, gives the theorem. Okay. And now just to summarize, so this proof is really important because of these techniques. So the symmetrization by the ghost sample is something that happens very often in learning theory, where we apply it, for example, to shattering coefficients or something like that. And that's a combinatorial quantity that we can then evaluate. Then we also, in this symmetrization by the Rademacher random variable is something that occurs very often. And then this whole proof strategy, like as it's done here, is something that you can see very often. And I think the main intuition you should have is, in fact, this one here, that we want to, or maybe we start here, we have this annoying supremum, we want to bring that supremum over something that's finite, and we can do it by the symmetrization. I think that's the first thing, the symmetrization by the ghost sample, that's the most important theorem, and from there on it's just cranking the handle.